Good evening, and welcome to the University of California, Irvine. We're here tonight to talk about the often untold story about how war impacts women and how women are fighting for peace. The event's been planned for many months, but we actually are very fortunate that one of the women who's featured in tonight's program just this last week was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, and we're very pleased about that, and you'll hear more about that as we go forward. You know, one of the things that we say a lot about our university is that we're very committed to educating the whole person. We speak about academic excellence and research excellence, but also about leadership excellence and character excellence, which are things that we believe it's very important to be able to develop. And one of the ways that we really focus on leadership excellence and character excellence is with partnerships with leaders in the world who are exemplars of the things that we would like to practice. And one of those is our dear friend Kelly Smith, who I'd like to be able to introduce to you all and have you here.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Chancellor Drake, and thank you all for coming tonight. We're very thankful to have the partnership with UC Irvine. And tonight, the Center for Leadership and Peace is also very thankful for this partnership with PBS SoCal to bring attention to the documentaries of Women, War, and Peace. Thank you all for coming, and it should be a really amazing night. I also want to thank Coast Magazine and everyone there for being our media sponsor.
We mentioned PBS SoCal. Mel, would you like to stand and just be recognized? This is Mel Rogers, who's the president of PBS SoCal, and tonight's program wouldn't have been possible without your help, and I know you'll be saying a few words to us later on. And now I'd like to introduce our panelists, who will come out in order. The first is Roxanne Varsey, UC Irvine Associate Professor of Anthropology and Film and Media Studies. Roxanne? And Roxanne will come out shortly. Actually, she was associate professor a few moments ago. She's now assistant professor. She's going to be a graduate student before long. But we'll give her a moment. Let me tell you who you'll see. So Roxanne Varsley will be coming out first. After Roxanne, you'll see Abigail Disney, who is an award-winning filmmaker and a philanthropist, and is responsible for some of the footage you'll see tonight. And then the third. Here we go. So first, Roxanne Varsley. And next we'll have Abigail Disney, who is an award-winning filmmaker and philanthropist.
And you're out there.
And finally, someone who you all know, Academy Award-winning actor Gina Davis. And in addition to the work that Ms. Davis has become known so well for around the world, she is one of the world's leading advocates for women as well, and we really appreciate having you all here.
Thank you
very
much.
Thank you.
Well, I'd like to once again welcome all of you and welcome our amazing panelists tonight. I was saying earlier that hopefully this will just feel like we're sitting around the kitchen table and really putting the focus on the work that you guys have done, because we've already had a good time talking in the car. And I'm on the stage here with one genius, I understand, and two doctors. So tonight I'm going to give you a brief introduction for each of them. They have amazing accomplishments that they're too far to list, but I'll give you a taste of each one of them. Then we will just show you a little clip of all the documentaries that I encourage you all to watch on PBS throughout this entire month. And then after that, we'll do a little kitchen table talk, and then we'll go on to open up the questions to all of you. So we'll start with Roxanne, who is Roxanne Varsey, Associate Professor of Anthropology here at UC Irvine. She's also Associate Professor of Film and Media Studies. She has a PhD from Columbia University, as does Miss Disney.
Piece of cake, right?
They're very well studied. She was born in Iran to an Iranian father and American mother, and their family migrated here to the U.S. after the Iranian Revolution. She's also a filmmaker as well as a very accomplished award-winning scholar and writer, published writer. Miss Gina Davis, sitting right here to my right, is an Academy Award winner. also a global or Golden Globe winner. And many of her roles have been cultural landmarks. She really has stepped out as a powerful woman in the roles that she's chosen to do in Hollywood. One that we all remember is Thelma and Louise. And she got to work with Brad Pitt and drive a car off a cliff, which I've thought about many times. And my other favorite was when you played a woman president. I mean, yes. Right. Wow. You did a great job, and you showed that it can happen. And you really, I loved that. And that was called Commander Chief,
right?
And that's where you got your Golden Globe. And she also played a baseball phenomenon in a league of her own. So, but besides that, she's an athlete in her own right, and was at one point ranked as the 13th
archer
of the U.S.
Right.
So she's very talented in many ways, and the genius part comes from being certified Mensa member.
Right. Well, you don't get to join it and then become a genius. You have to.
You have to be born one, which I think all three of you are. I'll step back from that title and just excuse me for any mistakes I make. But besides that, the reason she's here tonight is to really talk about the work of the Gina Davis Institute of Women in Media and the effect that media has on women's perceptions of themselves. And leading into that is the work that Abigail's done. Abigail's done a set of documentaries that feature real women and the power that they each had to make a change within their countries, as we'll talk about later. But let me give you all of her little accolades too, because they are huge. She's degrees from Stanford and Yale, as well as her PhD from Columbia. She created the Daphne Foundation before she did her documentaries that provided millions of dollars to grassroots community-based organizations working with low-income individuals in New York City. She's also formed the organization Pieces Loud that supports organizations focused on peace building and helping them end conflicts through peaceful and nonviolent methods. Thank you, Abigail, for all the work you've done. Thank you all for all the work you've done. And thank you for being here. So, Abigail, I have to start the evening with the announcement that was made just this past week and the journey. I'd love you to tell us about your journey to Liberia and how your documentaries really brought their message to the forefront and the world, and now they are Nobel Prize winners.
Yeah, well, I can't take credit for the lovely Yemeni woman, Tawakul, and I can't take credit for Ellen Sirleaf. She sprung Holy Form to the presidency before I got there, but I'm gonna take off my pearls because I think they are bugging me.
Oh no.
I know, don't, we're not gonna think about that now. Think about it tomorrow. But I got to Liberia in 2006, about 3 months after President Sirleaf was inaugurated. I had been asked to go there because I was interested in women's political leadership. And, we were a group of women looking to support President Sirleaf and see if there was anything we could do supportive of her presidency. And, you know, it was in the air, the story. You know, people referred to it, people mentioned it. You know, but nobody actually sat down and told me the whole story, I think because they just assumed I knew. But I didn't know. Nobody knew outside of Liberia. It was turning into folklore right in front of my eyes, and that's the first step on the way to oblivion, especially in women's history. So to me, I thought, well, this is, first of all, it's sort of a horrible injustice that these women risked their lives and worked so successfully and creatively. And nobody knows them, and nobody has any idea. But second of all, you know, from the work I've done with women's organizations and community-based organizations, I know what a light each of them is to the other. You know, and when they hear about each other, they tend to get more strength and gather steam. And I thought, wow, if you could lift up a story like this, what would it unlock in other people? So I came home kind of obsessed with making this film. I had never made a film before. my brother makes films. I come from a little bit of a filmmaking background. So I had thought about it, but never really wanted to. And finally, I just kind of reconnected with an old friend who was just a very terrific director. And that was God's way of saying, just make the damn film already and shut up about it. So we made the film. And along the way to making the film, when I heard the story, I'd never heard of Lema. Lema was somebody we met on the way. And when Ginny, my partner, and I sat down and talked to Lema for the first time, I mean, we were practically levitating. This woman was so charismatic and so well-spoken and so able. And no one had any idea who she was. So we opened at Tribeca, and Lema got up in front of an audience and did a Q&A and absolutely just knocked people sideways. And it's been like that ever since, for 3.5 years since the film came out. And I've been with her, you know, in 1,000 places that are pretty intimidating. You know, the State Department and the World Bank and the Council on Foreign Relations, the Clinton Global Initiative. She walks into the most intimidating places and she is not worried about it. And she lifts her game in every room we go into and says exactly to the room she's in what this room needs to hear. You know, I took her to my daughter's high school a couple of years ago, and there were, you know, 17-year-old jaded, private school privileged, you know, New York City kids weeping because they really felt like they'd been altered in some way. So, I really believed in her and made sure a lot of people saw the film so that, you know, the word would get out about who she was and what she was capable of, and luckily it got out far and wide and into Norway, and, you know, I'm glad they did what they did. It's a beautiful thing.
What do you think inspired her? What moved her to do what she did?
Well, she'll tell you, first of all, all of their backs were against the wall. I mean, it is hard to start a movement like this if you don't really feel like your life is in danger. The whole country had flooded down into Monrovia and were being, you know, sieged. There was mortar fire coming into the city on top of these people who were surrounded on three sides by water and one side by enemies. So that's as much as you're going to get your backs against the wall in any circumstance. And it was really just enough. This is enough already. I mean, how many years do we have to do this ridiculous thing? But the pivotal moment in the film and in the movement was when they get Charles Taylor to go to the peace talks in Ghana, and then they basically set up a shop in Ghana, you know, and actually it's not in the film, but she said to us that when they started singing outside of Ghana and Charles Taylor's car went by for the first time, he slowed just enough for them to see him roll his eyes, because they were like, oh man, these girls are here. I love them. When the talks became so cynical and broken down, they surrounded the building and they locked arms and they took everyone hostage for the women of Liberia. It's an incredible story. And it's all there on film. You can't argue with what she accomplished.
Yeah. One question I had after seeing the film was, our governments, do they have an incentive to end war, to find peace, if they don't have a grassroots movement like she created?
Well, I mean, the United States is its own kettle of fish with a very particular set of motivations around war and peace. We're driven by many, many, many things. But I think for the most part, I mean, Clausewitz was a philosopher of war in the 18th century who said that war is politics by other means. But it's kind of economics by other means, more and more. And the 5 permanent members of the UN Security Council are also the 5 largest exporters of weapons around the world. We've built ourselves into a little bit of a box canyon around conflict. We're going to have to make some pretty fundamental shifts in the culture and in the economics of it in order to really stop this.
Roxanne, I see you nodding down there.
I agree.
You grew up in a war zone, and you've studied war. Both of you I find fascinating because you were interested in wars and read about them and studied them. Can you speak to that also?
So I went back to Iran in 91, right after the war ended, and because I had missed the war, actually, for the most part, I was there during the revolution. It really separated me from the rest of the Iranians, and I became obsessed with finding out what it was like to live there, why it basically created an identity for people. And based on that, I did field work on veterans of the Iran-Iraq war front, and I really wanted to look at what motivated people to go to a war front, what it was that motivated them. I found a lot of it had to do with media, actually, which we can talk about.
Yeah, and since both of you are filmmakers, that was another, you have so much in common, the two of you, and how does war and the effects of war and the women, especially the effects on women, how is that translated in media, in film? And is it translated in a way that is really showing what happens?
In the Iranian case, women in particular are in the public sphere to sort of portray or to play a certain kind of role. And women in the Iran-Iraq War in particular were put in the public sphere to be mourners, to be the mothers of heroes, and to sort of just publicly be there for congratulatory purposes if your son is martyred, but they never really had a voice beyond that. And it wasn't really until after the war when, there are two different discourses. There was the government discourse about martyrdom, and then there are the people who are trying to mourn the war outside of that discourse. And a lot of these mothers fall in between. As Virginia Woolf said, as a woman, I have no country. I'm countryless because I don't play into that kind of thing. And it's kind of the same thing with mothers. You know, if you had a son who went off to the war and came back paralyzed, or if you had a son who went off and was martyred, or if you had a son who didn't go off, you're in these different sort of situations in terms of state discourse. But you're reacting the same way. You're still picking up all of the things that the state doesn't do, which is taking care and rehabilitating, you know, veterans, basically picking up jobs that, you know, jobs that people can't do anymore. An entire generation of Iranian men was lost to that 10-year war. So it really shifted the public sphere. So there are a lot of women in the public workforce. It's a lot like World War II with Rosie the Riveter. It is that kind of thing. So it shifted things for women socially, but for the most part, women really had to pick up and clean up where the government wasn't continuing to fund, you know, veterans programs.
You know, that those roles, those public roles that women took, are basically always what's in the public narrative around war. And you can go back to the Iliad and you'll find the women who mourn, the mothers of heroes, the women who send their voice off and motivate them, and the women who are sexual rewards, too. And you know, the word hooker comes from a Civil War general whose camp followers were prostitutes and they were called hookers girls. It's, you know, this is another piece that's always, always, always in the narrative. And my friend just wrote me the other day because she'd seen the Bosnian film last week and she said, you know, until I saw the film, I never really thought about the fact that in my art history class, Art History 101, we studied the rape of the Sabine women, which is this, you know, quintessential romantic film. And I mean, oil painting. And she said, we talked about the angles, we talked about the painting, we talked about the construction of it, we talked about the men, and no one in this called the rape of the Sabine women, and we still managed to elide their presence in it, which is really extraordinary. So, but we know, and one of the things we wanted to visualize for people, that women step up, they fight what's happening, and then there's this enormous project of holding these communities together. When we talk about civilian populations, which are anywhere from 70 to 90% female in wartime, when you say women and children about civilians, what you really mean is women, and then all the people who are depending on those women to survive. So when you think about civilians that way and you don't think of them as primarily women populations, and not only women populations, but women who are saddled with such an extraordinary burden of holding everything together while this other cultural preoccupation is occurring, we first of all, we miss the story, and we second of all lose the enormous wisdom that they're gathering in the process of holding these communities together. They know what needs to happen when the war is over. They know whether it's roads or water that have to happen first. They know where the guns are. They know who the bad guys are. They know where the trouble is brewing. And yet, over and over again, and that's why actually when I look through the literature, actually there's one character in the Iliad that we never pay attention to, who's the only other figure or role for a woman, and that's Cassandra. And Cassandra is a prophet. You know, she sees the future, but she made Apollo mad, so he curses her by no one will listen to her. How many? This is so the woman's experience. I think Homer was actually a woman. So she totally knows what's going to happen. She comes out, she goes, guys, you're all going to die. This is terrible. There's going to be a horse. She tells them everything. And they're like, ah, shut up, Cassandra. Go be quiet over there. And then after she's been proven right, no one circles back and says, you know, Cassandra really had it figured out.
That's because she's busy.
You know, which
up
is incredible. And in our Afghanistan film, you know, we're following these, the Afghan Women's Network. And the Afghan Women's Network has been saying since 2001, don't trust Rabbani, don't trust Sayaf. Please, Karzai is very, very corrupt. Can we please get better people in this parliament? They have been saying this since years before our government ever started to have its doubts about Karzai. And you would think that we would, now that we have been ignoring Cassandra for 10 years in Afghanistan, have the good judgment to go back and listen to what she's got to say now. Because she's got a lot to say that would be really of good use to us.
I think it's the story of women not being heard is part of what Gina's also working on. And in researching those new Nobel Prize laureates, I learned that only 15 of 124 Nobel Peace Prize laureates since 1901, only 15 are women. Very small percentage. And Gina, I know your institute does a lot of research around this. And some of the numbers that I've heard are staggering. I'd love you to share those with everyone here.
Right. Well, our institute is devoted to research on gender depictions in media, specifically of the female depictions in the media that kids see. Like 11 and under is what we're mostly focusing on. So G and PG movies and TV shows that are aimed at kids. And what we found, we now have sponsored the largest amount of research ever done on this topic, and it covers a 20-year span. And what we found is there are far more male characters than female. It's about one female character for every three male characters, unless it's a crowd scene, and then it's only 17% female characters, kind of like Nobel Prize winners. rare, but you know, wonderful.
And congresswomen.
And congresswomen are 16%. See, we'll get into that number later. But and the way it's like I heard this great Woody Allen joke about a restaurant that he says, not only is the food so horrible, but the portions are so small. So, it's kind of what women's characters in kids' entertainment are like right now. There's very few, and the ones that are there are very, very narrowly stereotyped. They're either serving as eye candy, or they're sidelined from the real action, or they're hypersexualized. Even in G-rated movies, there's a tremendous amount of hypersexualization of female characters. We found that they wear animated female characters, wear the same percentage of sexually revealing clothing as live-action female characters in R-rated movies. So there's an incredibly strong message that's being sent to kids over and over, and this crosses all studios. You know, no one's doing better than anybody else, and also nothing has improved in the 20 years that we studied. There was a small amount of improvement, such that if we add female characters at the rate that we have been over the past 20 years, we will achieve parity in 700 years. And we're fighting to cut that in half, just right, you know, right off the top, cut it in half. So the whole reason that I started this and got into it was because of my own daughter and watching, you know, G-rated videos and things with her, and realizing, oh my God, where are the female characters? What kind of message is she getting from this when there's few female characters and they don't do the interesting things? That's kind of what got me started, because we're in effect enculturating generation after generation to see women as less important. We don't take up half the planet. We don't do as many interesting things. So that's why I'd like to try to impact what kids see from the very beginning, because all over the world, women are are devalued in every culture. And I think a big part of it is the media representations that they're shown.
Can you tell us a little bit about your See Jane project?
Right. Well, this is what we do with the research. Because I'm in the entertainment industry, we go directly to the people that are making the movies and TV shows, the networks and the studios. We go to the Writers Guild and the Animators Guild and the casting directors, and we present our research. And the actual great news is that they're floored, they're shocked, they're completely stunned by the data that we show them. And I think it speaks to, I mean, you know, they're making this stuff, and they don't realize how few female characters there are or how they're portrayed. And I think that speaks to the fact that that's all any of us ever saw when we were kids. There's only, anybody who's alive has only ever seen this huge imbalance in the ratio of male to female characters. And I mean, when I was a kid, there weren't female characters I wanted to pretend to be. My friend and I acted out the Rifleman after school. Because I was taller, I would be the father, and she would be my son. So, but we didn't know. You know, when you were a kid, you don't know that this was strange, that there weren't any female characters we wanted to pretend to be.
Well, you were just telling me a little earlier, too, that now the number one thing girls want to be when they grow up is a
reality star. Yeah, I just heard that. We didn't. I know. Kim Kardashian specifically is what they cite as the number one goal for high school. We didn't do this research, but somebody told me, and I
give up.
I had that exact reaction. Unbelievable.
Well, so, on a brighter note, I will say that what I see from taking the films around the world, Pray the Devil Bath to Hell went to 60 countries. And you would go into a place like Bosnia, you know, where these women are so different from Liberian women, and you're kind of expecting that they won't understand why you're showing them this film. And instead of that, they see themselves in this film. Mm. Partly because they're so starved of images that feel like their own experience. Right. And they trace themselves all over the film, and then what they end up doing is saying, well, that's what they did there, what am I gonna do here? And they did this in every country we went to, and they would work their way into a very pragmatic, very political conversation about how to address whatever were the local problems that they had. And it wasn't like, we need reproductive health, and we, you know, always the things that we associate with women's issues. They would be talking about the things that benefited the whole community. What are we going to do about water? What are we going to do about sewage? The road isn't properly paved. Those kinds of things, the schools. And this happened in the Congo, in Peru, in Cambodia. The same, you could practically set your watch by the way it would evolve in that. And I think that this invisibility of women is actively hurting all of us, not just girls.
Right.
But boys too, and men.
Yeah.
Because it also says to the men and the boys, you know, you have to carry more. Mm-hmm. You know, and that also has a price. And it also is limiting and narrowing in its way as well. And you know, let's face it, men are just as hard on each other, or maybe worse, about the masculine role than they ever are on us about being women. So, you know, there is an enormous, first of all, God knows how many stories. You know, I keep watching what comes out lately. Every Friday I watch the new movies come out, and I think, does anyone have a new idea? I mean, Charlie's Angels? Really?
Oh, God.
Really? You know? So there are a lot of ideas and stories,
right,
there if this kind of weird unconscious resistance to just visualizing women could be removed.
Right. Right. Iran is a very interesting case because it's kind of this petri dish where there hasn't been allowed a lot of Western television for a long time, and you can see the effect on women. They're actually stronger. Young women in the Iranian public sphere have a very strong sense of self, and I wonder if it isn't a bad thing that we don't get American reality television.
Oh, yeah.
And domestic violence was down in Iran, and I know that at one point, you know, everyone here was very afraid of my going to Iran. Oh, Iran is so violent, it's so dangerous, are you going to be okay? And as I was leaving Iran, my cousin said, well, we want to go study in the States. And my aunt said, no, not there. Oh, my God, have you seen their films? I was like, oh, she's got a really good point. You know, and I teach modern Iran here at UCI. And one of my students, we were talking about, you know, women and this and that. And she said, so basically, Western feminists want Iranian women to wear miniskirts? And I said, okay, no, I'm getting this all wrong. Right. So it's interesting. It's interesting how that works.
Well, you make a great point because 80% of the media consumed worldwide is made in America. Mm-hmm. So we're the ones exporting this negative image of women all over the world. And I was in Washington recently at an event, and a woman came running up to me afterwards and said, please, I'm from the Congo. And please help us. Why are you sending us these horrible TV shows? Well, she didn't mean me, but she meant, you know, America. She said, please help us.
And
she said, why are you sending us the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills to the Congo? And I said,
How's that helping us?
I wish I knew. But it's awful. We're really, you know, impacting other cultures around the world in such a negative way.
And also the flip side of the negative image of women is this, you know, highly glamorized, romanticized, aestheticized violence, which are videos and you know,
right,
Transformers and, you know, these highly aestheticized rituals of violence, which, you know, there's room for that in every culture, but if you look at the weight it takes up in ours. And, you know, I always tell people, just imagine combat. Just imagine it. You know, and then ask yourself, have you ever actually been in a war? Do you really, you know, you got all that from Saving Private Ryan and all these, you know, where basically there are meetings where people say, which sounds more like a gut shot? Is it a cantaloupe or a watermelon when I hit it with a hammer? These are what Foley guys are doing to make Saving Private Ryan as real as it is. So, you know, we have to remember that all of that is fiction. Somebody wrote it, somebody lit it, and set directed it, and edited it. It is not necessarily a reflection of what really happens in wartime.
The Iranian military loves that film, though. They said that was the best
it
fiction.
It is the best film.
Of war
it's a
that
beautiful
they had
war
seen.
Film. I mean, it's a beautiful war film, but it's, but it's still, you know, I mean, I'm struck when they're house-to-house fighting across Normandy, you know, like, this is the kind of thing I always say, is like, well, the houses. People lived in the houses. Where are the people?
Where's the people?
They didn't evaporate into thin air. And I know that's not what Spielberg is doing in that particular film, but there is no particular film that tells us where they went. I was so struck. I read a letter from a British soldier who's riding home in 1938, and he's in the North African desert, and they've set up their camp. And he's writing home to his parents, and he's sort of a jokey light tone. And he's like, oh, we're British, and we're so efficient. We've got our mess tent set up and our canteen, and the line at the brothel is four men deep because there are only three women in it. And I'm sorry, but that makes my stomach turn because, you know, there are a bunch of questions there. First of all, why is it sort of amusing to say this? Second of all, how old are these girls? Where did they come from? Where are their families? Do they want to be there? And can they quit? And if they quit, is somebody going to drive them through the desert back to wherever it is they came from? You know, what happens if they get sick? You know, you just take the camera or the pen out of that guy's hand and give it to one of those girls, and what does the war look like from where she is? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, also when we think of war, we think of combat, and combat isn't war. War is bigger than combat, right. You know, and General Grant said, you know, war is 99% boredom and 1% terror, because 1% of it is combat. The rest of it is, where do I find the water? Where do I find the firewood? How will I keep my children safe? You know, where's the job? Where can I earn money? That's what war is. It consumes like a fire everything in the culture. Mm. You know, and it affects every aspect of everyone's life.
Look at our education funding. Mm-hmm. Where did that go?
Yeah.
Sorry, but I'm here at the University of California, so I have to say,
yeah.
Where did it go?
What are the choices? Where are the choices?
We've been at war, you know.
Yeah, those.
That's where our resources go, yeah.
So that being said, I realized I forgot to introduce the
trailer,
and we will bring that on so that everyone can get a good taste of exactly how it is that Abigail brought reality, some of the real reality, not the Saving Private Ryan.
I think of it as true reality.
Yeah.
May no substance. Do not abuse women.
We are fed up with the war.
They thought that none of us would survive to tell the truth. You cannot take our land away from us.
The frontline discussion of wars, and this is what the newspapers report on, the fighting tactics, the troops, the politics, the borders, the weapons, the armies, all of these things. That is a men's story. The backline discussion of the story is how you actually exist and live and continue on living in war. That's a woman's story. And that story has never been told.
Warfare is a very different proposition now, in which civilians are not, quote, collateral damage, as we once called them, but really very much in the center of the war zone.
The ordinary civilians are the ones who feel the brunt from the hunger, they watch their children die, the women are the ones raped, and then after conflict, when the wars the end of the wars are being negotiated, they are never considered.
Women say, stop violence! Stop violence! Stop violence!
I think it's way past time that we redefine what we mean by war, because there are no front lines in the wars in today's world. The fact is that in today's wars, the primary victims are women and children.
Llegó un grupo de hombres a mi casa. Yo me asusté mucho porque eran paramilitares. Yo les hablé muy fuerte, pero después, cuando terminé de hablar, yo dije, Dios mío, ¿yo qué hice? Salí temblando del susto porque pensé que me iban a pegar un tiro. Yo estaba esperando mi segundo hijo y el susto. Yo tuve mi bebé de manera prematura. Entonces se me murió. Yo hasta hoy digo, ¿por qué no estoy muerta? Porque todo quien le hablaba así era hombre o mujer muerta. Y bueno, yo creo que Dios todavía me quiere viva en este mundo para hacer muchas cosas por mí, por mi familia y por mi gente.
Clemencia Carabelli is one of the leaders of her Afro-Colombian community. She found that in wartime, women could organize more freely than men.
En la zona donde estoy, hay una red de mujeres afros. Cuando los paramilitares hacían control o hacen control en el territorio, los hombres no asesinados son tildados de guerrilleros. Buenos días. Entonces, la mujer desarrolla un papel clave porque, de alguna manera, es la que se puede mover.
Carabelli is a familiar face along this road. But for her, the road is filled with painful memories.
Asesinaron más de 600 personas aquí en la zona. Y esos asesinatos ocurrieron aquí en el puente, un puente que queda aquí sobre el río Cauca. donde los paramilitares mataban a la persona y la tiraban al río.
The death threats and the killing in Cauca have not ended.
Fue una masacre de 8 mineros que fueron asesinados. Y hasta hoy no sabemos quién fue que los asesinó.
The men were shot as they were leaving work at the gold mine.
Para nosotros eso es como una advertencia que estaban como haciendo a nosotros. Mucho estábamos muy asustados de eso que está pasando, porque eso es como casi siempre que ha pasado, empiezan como en las comunidades asesinando a otra persona como para que uno se asuste y se vaya.
It's another deadly incident in the war for this valuable land.
International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia is now in session.
For the first time in history, an international court is hearing a case about camps set up specifically to rape women.
Three Bosnian Serb defendants are accused of systematically raping Muslim women and reducing women and girls to sexual slavery.
Defendants Zoran Vukovic, Radomir Kovac, and Dragoljub Konarec, petty commanders in Bosnian Serb paramilitary units, are accused of helping imprison Foch's women and children.
Day one was a big deal.
Of committing rape, often.
There was this sense of finally it's happening.
All three defendants have pled not guilty.
Being able to see these people led into the courtroom provided me with some sense that everything is normal in the world, that if these people are arrested and they are being led by the guards and put on trial, that we still function as human beings.
Witness, do you see your name?
Yes.
Next to your name, do you see a number?
The witnesses all opted for the protection where their faces would not be seen and their names would not be used.
Throughout these proceedings, you will be referred to by that number. Do you understand?
Inside the courtroom, everybody could see everything. We could see the expressions, we could hear the voice intonations, but outside, you can't see that at all.
He forced all three of us to strip, always with this knife in his hand. He always had this knife.
So this case, it's a case that really lacks a face.
And then he said, you're now going to go naked down to the Drina River, and that he would slit our throats there and throw us into the river.
You can't see how young the witnesses are. You don't hear the anger in their voices.
Didn't anyone try to protect you? Oh, really? They were ridiculing us, the people who were watching. Who do you think would protect us?
17 days into the trial, Witness 99 took the stand to tell the world what had happened inside of Partizan.
The whole truth and nothing but the truth.
I wasn't ashamed. I was actually proud and full of strength. I looked him in the eye. How come he's not the one who was ashamed? I wanted to prove what I had survived and what had happened.
To the Bible, we saw what Esther did for her people, that she went in sackcloth and ashes, saying, I mean it.
I
Liberian women that love to do their hair and put on jewelry and makeup were not allowed to do any of those things.
We wore plain white clothes with the hair tie. We wore the white, singing to people we were out for peace. We are determined and nobody gonna deter us. We're gonna find a strategic point where Taylor gonna encounter us and give us some attention. And this is how we decided to sit at the fish market every day. Thousands of women, including ITPs, internally displaced persons, went. It was the first time in our history in Liberia where Muslim women and Christian women were coming together.
And we had a big banner that said, the women of Liberia want peace now.
Charles Taylor said, those who think they can come out in the street to embarrass themselves, come out, I'm waiting for you. I said nobody, N-O-B-O-D-Y, nobody will get into the street to embarrass my administration.
We were not afraid. My mother was like, they will beat you people or they will kill you. And we said, well, if I should get killed, just remember me that I was fighting for peace.
No one from the Women's Network knows whether Karzai will invite them to the Jirga. Hasina, Safi, and the others meet anyway to devise a strategy.
موضوع دومی که ما زنان یعنی زنایی که در جرگه هستن یا می زنایی که اگر میرن در جرگه نمیرن کوشش کنم که هر قدر میتونم کرزای باید حمایت کنم قوی بشه اگر ما کرزای ما ما شخصیت پرستی که معلوم نیست
کرزای در مدرسه نیست کرزای بر 5 سال است رئیس جمهور است باید اینمی حمایت شود.
While they debate whether to support Karzai, it is unclear whether he will support them. He has promised women only 50 of the 1,600 seats at the Jirga. But Secretary Clinton pressured Karzai to get them more. With Clinton's help, 20% of the delegates will now be women. Safi is chosen to be one of the delegates. Back in Kandahar, Shaeda Hussein learns that she will be a delegate as well. Her granddaughter wants to go too.
What is it?
Hussein leaves for Kabul quickly, before word gets out that she's a delegate. In Kandahar, the Taliban are assassinating people who cooperate with the government. Attending Karzai's peace conference could bring a death sentence.
Several documentaries in Women, War, and Peace, and Abigail, when I watched them, I had different emotional reactions to each one. Bosnia crushed me. Afghanistan made me wonder who designed the burqa. And Liberia was inspiring, and I'm curious, when you were making each one, what experiences did you have that were different within each one?
Each of them has their own little emotional world, mm-hmm. and it reflects this sort of individual personalities of the women and the personality of the country they're in, and so there's things that are common to all places and all women everywhere, and you can find them and trace them in here, and then there are the particularities that rise up, and we had to allow the women to show us the way as documentarians. So really, they needed to show us what was the emotional notes we had to hit and so forth. And Bosnia is the kind of place that's really hard. It's a dark place. And it's a really difficult place to go and not come back dark. Mm. But nevertheless, in every one of those places, what they all have in common is the way these women rise. I mean, that's what's constantly an amazement to me. Even the Bosnian women rise. You know, and they, so it's not what we see on the news. What we see on the news, if we ever see women in the context of war, they're refugees, they're lying by the side of the road, they're waiting for someone to feed them, they're waiting for someone to give them water, and that is just not the way it works. You know, they step up. They step up for each other, you know, and they step up for their cultures and their countries and their families and their communities. And to me, the best review we got last Tuesday when the first episode aired was from the LA Times. And she said, you know, it's really amazing because I'm not depressed. This is hard stuff, but it's really important because you come out on the good side, you know. And yes, they're Disney movies, okay? Sorry. but they're in very important way not Disney movies, in the sense that they really do go all the way through the hard stuff. When you get to the happy ending, it's a genuine happy ending. It's not a happy ending because you had blinders on all the way through. Or were pretending something that wasn't happening that was.
Or she married the prince.
Yeah, and that's really important to me. Because I find that I'm probably the most optimistic person I know, and I do not have blinkers on, and I see some of the hardest things in the world, and that's because the good news isn't in the way things turn out, it's in the way people are, you know, and it's in who people are around the world. And like, if you go to just one place that's under enormous stress, you'll find 50 women there who you would follow anywhere, and therefore you know that you're going to find that everywhere you go. And isn't that good news?
That's beautiful. Thank you for sharing. Yeah, I did notice too, there are podcasts for Women, War, and Peace on iTunes, and Gloria Steinem in one of them. For those of you students who may not know who Gloria Steinem is,
really?
Which is part of the reason why we're here now, huh? And the founder of...
Really? She's like Abraham Lincoln.
But one of her quotes was, it takes four generations to overcome an act of violence, the trauma of an act of violence, and you know, to your 700 years of changing our perceptions, how can we all rise up here in America where we're not in a war? How can I'd like to ask all of you.
Well, we are in a war. We're in three wars. I mean, that's actually really interesting to me that it doesn't feel like a country at war. Mm-hmm. And that's a very important piece, of the equation around conflict. So we do need to rise. And you know, it's really interesting because, you know, I go around talking about peace a lot, and I'm sort of, peace, yay, I'm a hippie. And I'm finding my allies, the strongest, the people who resonate most strongly with what I'm talking about, happen to be wearing U.S. military uniforms. Yeah. And I had the most extraordinary experience when I spoke at the U.S. Institute of Peace, and basically the highest ranking woman in the U.S. Navy, this Rear Admiral, came up to me and she was crying. 35 years in the service, and she said, don't ever stop saying what you're saying. Mm-hmm. We need this country to understand what we're asking of the men and women we send over, and we need to understand what we're asking them to do that's altering their lives forever and their characters. And so she gave me a medal right on the spot. Oh. And I will never forget that. But what I'm finding is, and Wendy Carpenter, the admiral, will say this to you, and this is something Mike Mullen has said and other people in the military have said, we're not going to fight the Battle of the Bulge ever again. You know, that idea that there's like a gridiron and there's sidelines, and so collateral damage is this physical implication that people are off to the side, you know, and they're not. And what war has changed since the end of the Cold War. So we have a proliferation of small arms around the world. Every AK-47 in the Soviet Union has been sold out into the black market. And there are AKs that can be traced to Colombia and Northern Ireland and Libya and Bosnia and Chechnya. They are on their sixth or seventh or eighth conflict. They don't die off after they've been used a few times. They keep getting used, and more of them keep getting made, 8 million of them every year. There are 875 million small arms in circulation around the world, and we're the largest exporter of them. So I think that what we need is to build a really vigorous culture of peace in this country. We don't have a discourse around peace. It's not a word that creates a sense of aspiration. It's not, you know, we should be wanting to be Gandhi, you know? And I don't see that in much of our culture. So I think we need to kind of like stay home and ask ourselves, like, how do we resurrect the idea that the peace is really a positive value, and that it's a verb and a choice and a thing you make and you wake up every morning and you choose to make in your life and in the lives of the people around you.
It's also a media thing. I mean, it's really important that the fact that we think we're not at war is because we don't see what we're doing. We constantly see what insurgents are doing. We constantly see what the other side is doing, but we don't see what we're doing. And we talked about this. We don't see what we're doing on the ground to other people. And when the whole sort of game changed and everything became very electronic and you could just sort of push a button, Paul Virilio talks about this, how the entire field completely shifted from a human being to a dot on a map. And when that shifts, everything shifts. If we don't see what we're doing to other human beings through our media, and that's why these kinds of films are important.
Well, and the second half, I just remember the second half of what Winnie Carpenter said. She said, because we're never fighting the Battle of the Bulge again, we're always going to be in an asymmetrical war as the United States, or a counterterrorism effort, or a counterinsurgency effort, or in interfering or intervening in a civil war or an ethnic conflict. You know, and those are wars that even if we brought everything we had to them and won, we would still in the long term lose them, really, because they would require of us things that we, you know, that aren't in our values to do. So the heart and the soul of what we go forward into is conflict resolution, is peace building, is the averting of conflict. And that's what's being said by people in uniform today in the US military after 10 years in Iraq. And 8 years, I mean, sorry, 8 years in Iraq and 10 years in Afghanistan. These are the people who really understand what they're saying, and we need to listen to them. You know, there are two things I see around the world, every single place I go, and one of them is Mickey Mouse. He's really interesting in stalking me, and I'm getting a restraining order soon. But I also see Rambo everywhere I go. It's really interesting, you know. It's not really a very significant film. I don't think anybody remembers it. It wasn't good, you know, and yet it made this huge impact. And it's part of that 80% of what we've exported with really, you know, all that Hollywood industrial complex of people who make good sound effects and all that highly realistic and then romanticized ethic of violence. And he's kind of like the Mickey Mouse of war, you know. And I wish we could apply that Hollywood industrial complex to a positive vision of what it means to build peace. Why isn't that sexy? You know, why is that not drawing the best of our talent in Hollywood? Why is that not drawing the eyes and ears and hearts of people in this country? We have to find a way to do that because our media is not worthy of us.
That's very interesting. Interesting point. And what does the media grab onto? And why is that? Why is it culturally that sex sells and violence sells? And is it our human nature or is it something we've learned? What, how would you all speak to
right.
that?
Right. Well, we have to ask ourselves why aren't we familiar with what happens to women in war? And why is this so revolutionary and something that we're, you know, absolutely stunned to see? And it's just part of our whole culture that we never look at things through women's eyes. And it's just been that way in our media for as long as we've had media. And it's not only in the scripted things, but it's in what makes news and who's presenting the news and what people consider to be newsworthy, you know, mostly is what happens to men and not what happens to women. So. It's culture-wide. There was a very interesting study last year that the White House Project did where they looked at 10 sectors of society, like the 10, let's say, most important sectors of society, like business, politics, law, academia, media, to find the percentage of women in positions of leadership or authority. And across the board, the average percentage was 18%. Which is kind of like Nobel Prize winners and everything else, and women in Congress. And it sort of begs the question, why in every sector of society has the participation of women as leaders stalled out at just about the same number? But that's about the percentage of women that are in entertainment media. And everywhere you look, we're not getting to critical mass. We're not getting to a third where you reach a tipping point and now you can move from gender to agenda. I didn't make that up. Murray Wilson says that, but it's very appropriate. If you only have a couple of women on a board, it's still about their gender. But if a third of the board is women, that's not an issue anymore. Now we're just people working together, you know.
Well, I think that's really important. And for me, I think that's an important message for peace is breaking beyond the boundaries of titles.
Right.
And our women, man, like you say, people, we are all people. And I think that's what your movies and documentaries all speak to, too, is we are all people here. And in general, we want peace. That's what I think you saw and you're speaking to. And I think that's the bottom line. People want peace, and you showed that so beautifully, and the women standing up for that, but women and men, I think, breaking down the boundaries is how we all realize the power that we have to work together. Mm-hmm.
And can I say, on the subject of working together, that's part of the reason I'm here, is I need your help. We all need your help to spread the word about this series. I mean, it's really, in fact, that word groundbreaking is kind of like, you know, it doesn't say anything to you, but it's groundbreaking.
This has
really never been done before. No one's ever succeeded in raising the money for such a thing. Nobody's ever had the idea for such a thing. Nobody's ever carried it through. It's the first of its kind. And so it's really hard to know how to get the word out about it. There's no pre-existing channel,
right.
You know? So I need you guys to generate the channel for me. I need you to tweet it and Facebook it and talk about it and turn on the television and find everyone you know with a Nielsen box.
Turn the television on.
And so Tuesday nights, 10 o'clock for the next 4 weeks, Pray the Devil Back to Hell next Tuesday. The following Tuesday is Peace Unveiled about Afghanistan. The following Tuesday, November 1st, is the war we are living, which is about Colombia, and then the November 8th final episode is called War Redefining. It really is a big kind of essay piece about why. Why is this matter, and why has it changed, and you know, why are we at a particular point in time where, you know, in fact, we can really make a genuine difference. That comment about Nuremberg is so interesting because, you know, there was a cable that went out from a French diplomat, actually, that said, you know, it would be too distasteful to talk about rape at Nuremberg. And, you know, it's not that this guy was a bad guy. He just didn't get it. And why would we expect him to get it? You know, there was nothing there for him to help him to get it. But what's changed is women have gone into the professions. They're prosecutors, they're magistrates, they're investigators. They're working across at all the levels of the international community. A women's movement occurred between 1946 and now, which created the environment in which those Bosnian women felt okay about speaking up, felt okay about demanding justice. Things have shifted in a way in the last 50 years to a point where, you know, if we really do build on our gains, something could tip.
I agree. So I think we should open it up to the questions that the audience has. I know we have quite a few out here, and I think we have a microphone coming up. And
do you want to give it to the?
It's right here.
Open it up to the people who can help.
Hi, so, okay, sorry. My name's Camille, and I go to the high school that's really close by here. And I've noticed that a lot of the boys at my high school, they feel like fighting for women's equality is just a girl thing, mm-hmm. because, well, they feel like they're guys and they can't contribute because they're not girls, and they feel like it's really not their responsibility. So how could we try to encourage them to get involved? And also to communicate that this isn't just a girl's issue, this is really a human issue. Thank you.
That's a great question. Yeah. You want me to do it?
That's an excellent question. Well, we can both do it. That's an incredibly important part of what needs to get across to people is that the empowerment of women is absolutely as beneficial for men as it is for women. It's as important for everyone. There's so much evidence now that societies prosper more, businesses earn more. Everything flourishes the more that women are empowered. And it's maybe the most important thing that we need to get across to young people like you and to everyone that it's important to men. I mean, we're frustrated a lot of times in our efforts, like when we, for example, had a seminar for casting directors. We invited all casting directors, but the audience that showed up self-selected as all women. There was like one man there, and it's because exactly what you said, that people have in their minds that, well, it's about women's stuff, so, you know, let the women deal with it. And I think about that even on like the scale of the UN. You know, they have these 8 Millennium Development Goals, and one of them is the is achieving gender equality and empowering women, number 3, and which is fantastic. But I sort of want to say, maybe all 8 really are about women, about raising up women. I mean, hunger and the environment and conflict and everything is impacted by improving the lot of women. So it's the most important message.
There's two pieces of the argument. One is, you know, because we all need it. And I remember I actually got Abraham Lincoln, Gloria Steinem, to come to my son's all-boys school and talk to them. And I just will never forget the way they hated being there. They were like, what are you making me listen to? And then she came out and swore like a truck driver, and they loved her, and they were eating out of the palm of her hand. And toward the end, she said, you know what it is? I think what I want you to do is think about the kind of father you have now. And then I want you to think about the kind of father you want to be. And what would have to shift between now and then for that to happen. And what I could feel almost palpably was this yearning in them. And I think there's a yearning in a lot of men for something different. I saw a yearning in my father when he watched my husband with our kids, and I know that he wished maybe he could have been that father to them. So there's, first of all, that it would really serve everyone's interests. But the other one is, and I don't want to let them off the hook on this one, because it's the right thing to do. You know, and if women have equal rights, I don't think angels will descend from the heavens or anything magic. You know, I just think it's the right thing to do. And no social movement has ever broken through until people who had nothing to gain by it joined. Mm-hmm. You know, and so you had white, Jewish, liberal people from New York and the Northeast going to Mississippi and getting themselves killed for black Southern people who in the civil rights movement. And when I got to Columbia, there were my peers being dragged off in handcuffs for apartheid half the way around the world. Nobody had anything to gain by that except that it was the right thing to do. You know, and what women have never had, you know, is a Michael Schwerner or, you know, someone who would take a billy club to the head for us or be dragged off in handcuffs for us. You know, and our version of being dragged off in handcuffs is unfortunately mockery, social exclusion, social prices. That's why men are, especially boys your age, are hesitant, because the social price is high. For feminists, since the beginning of time, mockery has been stop one on the oppression express. And so men who want to stand with us are going to have to be dismissed and mocked and made fun of, but that is going to have, that's what bravery is.
Well, one way to do that is to wear a veil if you're a man. That's what they did in Iran. A bunch of Iranian men put on a veil.
What?
And a lot of Iranian men in the diaspora are actually part of the women's movement because it's important to them, because their sisters are suffering and their mothers are suffering. If you have a sister or a mother, that's reason enough, but also because it's the right thing to do. I agree 100%.
Show support, yeah.
I'm not sure I need a mic. You know, the last couple of days I have had somewhat of a fear, and I have a question for one of the panelists here. There was a major event that happened and just broke in the news about Iran trying to murder or assassinate the Saudi ambassador. And I thought, well, that's terrible, but what scared me more than that was the way the news media was going and asking questions of presidential candidates of what would you do? And so many of the answers were, you know what? They need to be strong. They need to send them a message. My mind is going, oh, we need to go to war with Iran now over this? And so that, what I was afraid of is that would escalate from that interview in that, and then pressure being put on the people in power at this point to do something. And the first thing they think of doing is either bombing or doing this. And I'm thinking, you know what? You just need to calm down a minute. Take a couple of breaths, right? Because what would happen in that instance?
That would be a nightmare.
Yeah.
And that's our first reaction, usually, especially with the Middle East, is violence.
I mean, that's why I say we need to build a constituency for peace in this country. Because, you know, what if, you know, voters across the country wanted their leaders to respond with, well, I think that we should negotiate a solution. What if that sounded like a good answer instead? I mean, because they're not making that up. They have their finger in the wind for the most votes. And that's an indication of what this culture is asking of them, or at least voters are asking of them.
Again, it's our media. We don't see Iranian people. We see the Iranian military, we see Iranian militants, we see a very particular part of the population, but we don't see all of the people living in Iran who are making arts, who are writing books, who are living their lives on a daily basis just the same way we are that we would be bombing. We don't see that. We never see that before we hit the missile over there. We see like a video screen. It looks like a video game. This is exactly what it was like. I remember being in New York when we first went to war. There's a little red dot, and there it went. But we didn't see any people. So this, again, is a major shift that has to happen. I'm an anthropologist, so I like people, and I think we should see them.
One individual went to Iran, and it was published by PBS Radio TV. Rick Steves went to Iran and did a marvelous program, and I myself was shaking my head saying, Jesus, what a wonderful community. How beautiful these people are. How peace-loving. That was certainly a different take on Iran than what we see in
Yeah, I think very few people saw the candlelight vigils after September 11th that took place in Iran. I was in New York City, and I was in touch with friends in Iran. People had gone out and put candles all over the city. We don't see much of that. I think that's important. It's important in all of these places. That's why it's important who's holding the camera, who's setting up that frame. What, you know, whenever you set up a camera, you can say that just setting up a documentary camera is going to give you truth, but it's not. It's about where you place it exactly. It's about who's inside and outside of that frame. It's about who's behind the camera. It's about who's funding the film. All of that. These things are really important.
Do we have another question?
Testing, testing. Hi, good afternoon. My name is Chris, and I'm a student here at the University of California, Irvine. And first of all, I would like to thank everybody for coming out, especially everybody up there in the cast. So my question is, I know that I got a lot of emotions running through my body when I watched the video. And I'm pretty sure it was kind of harsh to film all that and going through the process of it. So I would like to know what emotions were running through you guys when you made the video.
That's a great question. I've definitely had my dark nights where I can't sleep because you spend a lot of time, you know, really searching your soul for, you know, gosh, why is it that we're as humans capable of the things that we do? It's really hard. But again, I feel like you really need to really take the blinders off and see all of it, because, you know, at the end of the day, people really do shine through. The vast majority of people are born and built for peace. That's just the way it is. And who's behind the camera? On September 11th in Gaza, there were Palestinians celebrating and shooting their rifles off into the air. But everybody who was actually there that day, you know, that was all on the evening news. I'll never forget it. Everybody who was there said, well, actually, if you just pan to the left a little bit, and then the rest of the way, 360 degrees around, you would have seen people who were crying, people who were appalled by the celebration, people who didn't want that. And why, you know, the widest angle lens will give you, what, 40% of a landscape? That, you know, we need to see all of it, the 360 degrees, because I guarantee you that as hard as things are to look at, the good news is really outweighs the bad news.
I think that's all we have time for questions. But I want to thank all of you for coming. You all are shining examples of living peace and being the change in the world. And for being the inspiration for everyone here to make a difference. So I'd like to call up Chancellor Jay to close the night.
Again, a round of applause for our panelists and for Charlie. And thank you for a really provocative and thoughtful series of questions and answers in the film. And I think you really show us the value of women being out there in the world and making sure that that can be shown more broadly. So I'm really pleased and proud to be a part of this evening. So thank you all very much again. Also tonight, if you can hold on for a few moments, one of the things that's really wonderful about this last year is that Orange County has been the hub, become the hub of Southern California's PBS broadcasting empire, and good for. And we're really pleased to be able to have PBS as a partner in this evening's event. And I'd like to introduce President Mel Rogers to come up and say a few words, Mel.
I know you all want to get back to your studies and various things, and so I'll be very, very brief. I'm not going to tell you anything that's nearly as important as what you've been listening to this evening, but I do want to say one thing, and especially to the students in here. I know you're busy, and I know your lives are crazy, and I know it's hard to keep up with everything, but you do use media. We all use media, and we use it every day. And a tiny sliver of the media out there is public media. The rest of it is commercial media. All of that commercial media out there exists for only one reason: to sell you stuff and make money. Public media is the only media to treat you like a citizen, not a customer. And if you would please do a little bit of budgeting of your media use, I know you don't want to be dealing with heavy issues all the time, but a little bit of budgeting of your media use to tune into public media, to watch PBS SoCal, to listen to KPCC radio, to do those things online that we offer as well, and find out what's really going on in the world and dedicate yourself to making a difference. That's why we're here, and it isn't going to work unless you tune in. Thanks so much. Good night.